Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have one apology from Miles Briggs. Our first item of business today is a decision to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. So moving on to our next agenda item, an evidence session to inform our inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. The inquiry is looking into how the Scottish Government is working with local authorities, employers and other partners at a local level to tackle child poverty through improving employability. This is our second panel on the theme of affordable and flexible childcare, and today we will focus on service delivery. I welcome to the meeting today's panel Susan McGee, Chief Executive of Flexible Childcare Services Scotland, and Rami Alkasha, Chief Executive Officer from CHAS. We are joined, who are joined in the room, and we have Kirsty Ramage, Project Leader, the Bells Bank Project, and Beverly Isdale, Chief Executive from First for Kids, who are joining us remotely. So a very good morning to you and thanks for joining us. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. We have roughly allocated about an hour and 15 minutes for questions and themes. Our virtual witnesses and members, please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Virtual witnesses, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on and before you start to speak. You can also indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans if you wish to come in on a question. Don't feel you will have to answer every single question. If you have nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's perfectly okay as well. We have a lot to cover this morning, so I would ask everyone to keep questions and answers as tight as possible. Colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question. And members online should use the chat box or our WhatsApp. So I'm going to invite members to ask questions in turn as agreed in our pre-brief. So can I firstly bring in James, who's here remotely. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. I'd like to start by asking Susan from Flexible Childcare Services, you describe yourselves as a test site for a scalable business model. What insights can you provide about how flexible services impact on child poverty?
I think flexible childcare, the delivery of that has a huge impact on child poverty in that it empowers parents to be able to enter or remain in work or study or even do the courses and support that prepares them to return to work. It also reduces the amount of money that families are spending on childcare. And if you think of the cost of childcare as £6 to £7 an hour, if somebody can, by booking flexibly just the hours they need rather than a set session, save a couple of hours a day, over a 5-day week, that could be £60 or £70 that helps them to move out of poverty and might pay for their food shopping so that they and their children aren't struggling to eat. So it does make a big difference. And certainly we surveyed families using our own services. We currently have between 800 and 1,000 families using the service each week. When we did the survey, it would have been around 800, and about half of those use the flexible childcare for reasons of returning to work or study or that type of thing. Others are families with additional support needs children. Of that, around 400 families, 94% of them had increased their income by up to £5,000 a year. So it had been a huge difference to families' lives.
Yeah, what do you think would be needed more than you're getting just now from either the Scottish Government or local authorities to increase the level of flexibility that's available? So, within preschool, school-age childcare as well.
Yeah, operating flexibly means it's harder to fill your service. As a commercial provider, you would be aiming towards 100% occupancy, probably realistically 90-plus percent occupancy. And you sell your sessions on a straight line basis, Monday to Friday, either half days or full days. It's really easy to fill it up. If you're selling it flexibly, just the sessions that families need, you do end up with odd gaps in that overall capacity that is really hard then to fill. So you really only get to about 70% maximum on occupancy that you can fill. Also, our own services, we tend to operate in areas where that probably aren't attractive to commercial providers. And we have families with multiple and complex needs that often require our practitioners to attend perhaps team around the child, social work. So there's lots of other agencies involved in the work that we do. So we also have to have higher staffing levels very often too, to meet that need. So in order to deliver a really flexible service for families in the most significant need, the cost of that is probably about £3 to £4 an hour more than is currently funded through the 1140 hours funding rate from most local authorities.
So basically you're saying more money, and do you think this should be coming from the Scottish Government, local authorities? How good is the relationship, for example, working with local authorities to ensure that you get the support that you require?
It can be difficult. Local authorities, I suppose, they're priority for their funded hours is around the education side of it and attainment. Although the parental employability is in there as one of those targets of that offer, it's perhaps not the priority one for local authorities. So there is often a question of about how children can learn if they're attending flexibly. And really, I think it's a non-question in a lot of ways, because children are learning all the time. So that's continually happening, and actually many of the families in the particularly high areas of deprivation where we operate wouldn't use other services, so it's a choice of our services or nothing, and that's the kind of approach. We probably need to work more closely perhaps with some of the local authorities' employability programmes and see if there's a connection there, particularly to support parents, because you could have the best employability programme ever, but if a family hasn't got childcare to enable them to work, then they're not going to go to work. So,
is there a difference in the needs in preschool and school age childcare, or do you just face the same problem with both?
Well, at the moment, it's the preschool childcare that's funded. The school age childcare isn't funded, and that is a big shock to many parents if they've worked through those early years and they've had some funding towards the preschool years, so their cost of childcare has perhaps gone down. They've been able to work a bit more. Maybe family circumstances have improved slightly, and then their child goes to school and suddenly there isn't funding anymore for after school or before school services. So that's a real shock to the system for some families, and something they struggle with. And we do see families actually at that point reduce working hours or stop working because they just can't find that. And children in certainly the early primary years, if not all primary years really, are too young to be going home by themselves and spending any significant period of time alone in the family home. And often in areas of poverty, perhaps they haven't got the things in the family home that they might need. So they might be going home to an empty fridge or no Wi-Fi access. So if they're coming to a club, they're getting food after school, they're getting access to services, support to do homework, outdoor play, all of those kind of things. So there's huge benefits for all children, particularly for children from families living with significant challenges.
It's amazing how times have changed when we think that there could be no food in the fridge or no Wi-Fi access, but that's the reality of life. Can I just ask you one last question, so you'd be really helpful, but can you tell me, are there particular issues with delivering a flexible provision in rural areas as opposed to urban areas?
Yeah, I think rural areas are a huge challenge for families looking for childcare, and certainly we often have people in touch that say they're looking for a place for their child, but they just can't travel to the nearest space that's available. And it's really difficult for a provider to deliver a sustainable service in a rural area, so that becomes very difficult too. There's certainly a big case there for use of the school estate, so that providers are able to have small clubs within the school premises in those areas, because obviously there is a school that families are able to travel to. And if that could be used for both school age and for younger age childcare by providers that step in and provide those services within those premises, that would certainly be helpful for families. And I think the other thing that could be explored around that is a hook-up with demand-responsive transport. So often in rural areas, there are demand-responsive transport services that perhaps struggle to be sustainable too, that maybe they're for people who are elderly and need transport, or people who have disabilities or additional support requirements and need transport. Could they also support families with young children? And does that tick two boxes, really? It helps families travel to the childcare services they need, but also helps the demand-responsive transport service to become more sustainable.
Yeah, that's very helpful. Convener, I see that Beverly looked to come in.
Yep. Happy to bring Beverly in. Thanks.
Thanks very much. I just want to echo really what Susan was saying there about the shock that parents get to find out that school-aged childcare is not funded. And it does, I think, have quite an impact on parents' careers, because they have this 3- and 4-year-old place, or a 2-year-old place now as well, and then suddenly they've got to start paying again, so it's a bit of a shock for them. But I think the flexibility thing for me, I would quite like to have a definition of what we mean by flexible. So is it flexible booking for parents, or is it flexible hours that our childcare is delivered on? Because there's talk of, you know, people who've got shift patterns, or people who work in the NHS, so it might be really late into like an 8 o'clock finish, and how that is much more expensive than me being able to say you can book whatever day you want between 8 o'clock and 6 o'clock. I might have enough people to fill childcare between 8 o'clock and 6 o'clock, but from 6 o'clock till 8 p.m, I might only have one child that needs that in the service that I've got.
Right, OK. Thanks very much for that, Beverly. Thank you, Convener.
I just wanted to open it up if any other panel member wanted to come in. OK, I'm going to move on to theme two, and that is Katie. Katie's with us remotely. If you want to come in, Katie, thanks. Can you hear us OK, Katie? Mummy. Katie, can you hear us okay?
No, she can't hear. Nobody can hear.
Okay, what I'll maybe do then is I'll move on to Jeremy then, who's going to take theme three, and we can come back to Katie. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel, both here and online. Thank you for coming along. Obviously, staffing costs are presumably your major pressure, your major cost for childcare providers, both preschool and school age. I wonder what other costs are you facing? Are these changing, and how are you coping with them? I don't know if anyone wants to jump in.
I think, yes, the staffing cost is the biggest cost. It's a ratio-driven business. You have to have a set number of staff per children. So staffing is the biggest cost for the service. However, cost of living is impacting really heavily on the services as well. The resources that we buy, the consumables, the food for the children, all of those costs are firing up really quickly. The costs of the fuel, the power for the services is rising. And also rents. So in some areas where we've been using local authority services, rents have risen massively on those premises to be able to provide the service. So I think that whole, I suppose any of the costs that are fairly standard for any business are rising rapidly for us. The the increase in real living wage, which we absolutely support, and we're an accredited real living wage employer, but the funding rates haven't kept up with the percentage increase on those costs. And of course, the cost of inflation has been higher than the increase in funding rates too. So we feel a wee bit like it's sort of being hit from all sides here at the moment, that trying to provide the service that really meets parents' needs, and the costs are going up and up to be able to do that. The staffing cost is also under pressure because we can't compete with higher salaries that are paid in local authority services. So there's a real pressure to push up costs even beyond the real living wage increase to try to attract good quality staff. And actually, the job that the people are doing within our services deserves to be a higher paid job. It's a really important job, supporting and developing our citizens of the future. So.
I don't know if anyone else has got a comment to make on that. If not, I'll move on. I'm interested just to go, a partner provider wage for funded early learning and childcare, keeping up with the rising costs? And what is the, can you just maybe expand a wee bit about, you know, is it getting worse as in the last couple of years, or has this been a thing that's been going on for a number of years, the differential?
Wait, anybody answers that?
Yeah.
There was a request from Beverly and Kirsty on your last point.
So, oh, sorry, my apologies.
Yeah,
sorry.
No, it's okay.
Sorry, I'll pull that question. Sorry.
I'll bring in Beverly if that's okay. Thanks.
Thank you. I think one of the additional expenses for us is the gaps that have come in our places from the changing pattern of parents working. So the whole hybrid working, where parents are able to work at home some of the time and are actually at their place of work other times. And so they maybe now only use our service 3 days out of five, and the other 2 days they're working from home. And so they have the children at home with them at the same time, rightly or wrongly. It obviously makes a difference to the amount of places that we have that are full, or all the mental places we have that are empty. So that's another a thing that costs us quite a lot of money. There are things like, we have had funding to develop the school activity and holiday fund for the last 2 years, and that has been cut this year. So all the work that has been done to develop that, we now have to try and find the money to carry on that, because the money is not there anymore. So that is another additional expense for the holiday provision that will come up this summer. School lets are the biggest part of, next to our staffing costs, which are 80% of our costs, our expenditure. It's school lets. And during the pandemic, because things were so tight, and we were just losing money, we chose to not pay our rent to the local authority, as one of the things that we just couldn't afford to pay at the time, and so have accrued debt. And I'm sure that other businesses will have accrued debt in different ways during the pandemic. And so paying that back will be a big issue for us to do over the next however many years. And you know, the local authority have been extremely kind to allow us to do that, but we now have this this bill that we need to pay them. But other things, everything that we do, every business thing that we do, so all of our telephone lines, all of our IT, everything has gone up by inflation. So yeah, everything is much more expensive now.
I don't know, again, does anyone else want to come in on that point?
Kirsty wants to come in. Can I invite Kirsty?
Yep.
Thanks.
Hello. Yeah, it was more or less just to say the same thing. Because we are third sector, all our work is done and paid for by grant funding. And we found that as well. The grant funding isn't going up, but everybody's expecting the wages to go up. So we're now in the position, instead of applying to maybe two or three major funders a year, we're applying to 17, 18 funders. Everybody's wages are paid from three and four and five different sources. It's really difficult to keep on top of that. And once again as well, the local authorities take all our staff because they can provide, you know, the trade generation as well. So it's a big hit as well. And we all, one of the biggest issues is cover. If we've got a member of staff off sick or annual leave, and we need to get bank staff in, that does.
I think, Kirsty, we seem to have lost your connection. I don't know if you want to try and come back in again. Sorry. Can you hear me okay, Kirsty? No, I'm afraid Kirsty can't hear me right now. We seem to be having some technical problems.
No.
Oh.
I can hear everybody.
Oh, you can? Right, okay. That's good.
Yeah, that me. I just one more point. As I say, covering staff absences is a real issue for us, but also when we're looking for bank staff, because we're in such a rural area, high deprivation, working in early years, you need your PVG, which is £59. You need to have registration with SSSC, which can be £20-25. And you might only get 4 hours work out of that. So it's really difficult to access banks.
Sorry, Kirsty, we seem to be losing you again. Can you hear us okay? We can always come back to you, Kirsty, and see if your connection picks up. Well, can hear you now, sorry. Thanks. If you want to turn your camera off, your connection, we might pick up your sound a bit better. No. Okay, we can always move on.
I don't know how much of that you heard, but it's the cost.
No, I'm afraid, Kirsty, your connection's really poor at the moment, so we will come back to you. Is it Rami? You want to come in, Rami? Thanks.
I just wanted to mention the point about staffing costs, and whilst Chas is not a childcare provider, we work with many families who are struggling to access childcare, and one of the barriers is often in relation to, for children with very complex needs, the level of skill that is required to be able to support that child in any setting, in or out of the home. And there, where we're looking at high levels of nursing skill that are required, the salary reference point is the NHS. So we're looking effectively for people with pretty much the skills that you would need to be providing nursing or nursing support work, but doing it with the NHS, and there is a huge gap emerging between NHS pay and non-NHS pay for those skills, and that's a real challenge for non-NHS healthcare providers.
Yeah, thank you. I think that's a really helpful point. Again, can I just go back to what we were discussing just previously very quickly, and that is in regard to partner provider rates for funded early learning and childcare keeping up with rising costs. I think you were saying no. That isn't the case. And I was just wanting to see, is that a kind of thing post-COVID, or has that been happening before COVID as well?
I think there were always concerns that that rate was not the same. Anecdotally, there's sort of figures that it's a couple of pounds more per hour that local authority per child allocation is that than funded providers get. So it has always been a concern, and it's something the sector has challenged in a number of ways on lots of occasions. I suppose as costs continue to rise, it's just becoming a bigger and bigger challenge for providers to support, really. And in some ways, PVI providers, who are those partners of local authorities, are supporting that policy because they're carrying some of that cost, and the funded rate can be below their own hourly charge-out rate. So by being a partner, they are losing on what their predicted revenue would have been. So the simple, I suppose, the really basic thing is the 10% increase in the real living wage. The inflation rate And yet the rate of increase in the funded rate for partner providers is nothing like that. It varies obviously across authorities, but it's gone up by nothing like that.
Okay. If I can move on, just one further question, Convener. I think in your statement, Susan, you said that targeted access to flexible childcare will cost more to deliver, but this higher funding may only be for a temporary period. I wonder if you could just expand on what these higher costs are and why is it only temporary rather than ongoing?
Okay. So the higher costs of delivering the flexible service are related to those gaps in filling your occupancy capacity. So you can't fill to 100% because you end up with bits that just won't sell. It's around the higher staffing levels required to attend the various meetings that come with providing a service in an area of complex need where families have much more need, and there are other agencies involved in those services. So there are those additional costs that come with it. The reason that we think it may be temporary, and we do need to do some more research with this, and we have had some discussions with the ELC Directorate actually about exploring that further to try and understand that period, is we're observing in our services that when families first come to us, some of them perhaps when they're first moving away from perhaps multi-generational unemployment in a family, life can be a wee bit chaotic when they're first starting to move away from that. So they may start work, it may be very sessional, 0 hours type contract. They may go into work, then come out of work because it's really difficult to get that routine established in a family. But after a period of time, we're observing that things tend to stabilise, and where families may have been booking really quite randomly flexible sessions to allow them to do an odd shift when they got a 0 hour shift and things like that. It starts to form a pattern, and it may be that it's a shift pattern, that it's 1 week on, 1 week off, or so there are different things around that. But we do think there is a pattern that starts to emerge. It does need further research and analysis to understand where that point is, that you would say, well, actually, that targeted higher rate perhaps isn't needed anymore now because that family are using a more standard model. I don't believe it would be a set time frame for every family. I don't think you could say it's only ever going to take 3 months, 6 months, because it would have to be person-centred and depends on the needs of that individual family. But it is something that's certainly worth further exploration and analysis.
Thank you, Camina.
Thanks, Jeremy. I'm now going to go back to Katie Clark, who can pick up on her themes there. Thanks, Katie.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And I was going to ask about workplace issues. We've heard a lot of evidence previously about the difficulties with recruitment and retention linked to paying conditions, indeed even the remuneration of those running small. And we've heard further evidence today in relation to some of the other financial struggles the sector currently facing. What do you think the Scottish Government can do about this?
Who would you like to ask, Katie? You just want to
I'm
open it up.
I'm happy if Convener, if you can see who would like to come in.
Okay. Anyone like to come in? Susan, thanks. Thank you.
So around the sort of workforce capacity and the recruitment challenges and things you're asking about, Katie, workforce capacity. There was obviously an increased need for people in the sector as part of the 1140 increase. And I think there has been a big scale up within local authorities have had more services that they have added. So they have had a big recruitment drive around the 1140. And lots of qualified people have gone from PVI sector, where perhaps they haven't been able to be paid as much, to go into those jobs. So there has been a real movement of the qualified and experienced staff from the PVI sector into the local authority services. we thought that was perhaps starting to stabilise, but then there's the deferred entry entitlement has come in this year. So again, local authority are in many areas looking for more staff to meet that deferred entry requirement, so that there's, again, more people going across into to local authority services, which makes that really difficult. I think also at the same time, we were obviously living through COVID, which had an impact on our colleges and training providers. So there's perhaps not been as many newly qualified entrants to the sector as well, which has been really challenging. So recruitment is really, really difficult. It's having an impact on quality of experience for Scotland's children, because we have inexperienced staff leading inexperienced staff, because you just can't keep that quality and experience within the services. So it's really challenging at the moment. There are more vacancies, I think, than there are people applying for them. People are competing for staff, so you're seeing recruitment bonuses being advertised to get people to sign up. So there's lots of different things like that happening, which in some ways is positive, because it improves conditions for people working within the sector. However, it's really, really difficult as a provider to do that and remain sustainable alongside the other challenges. I think there are some things that could be done around looking at the qualifications. So we are still a sector that's predominantly female staffed. It's got 96% female workforce. Perhaps if we widen the qualification criteria, included more outdoor, play-based, so different routes into the sector would be an interesting way to do it. And it might diversify the workforce some more as well, which would be a positive thing for everybody. Perhaps a boost on funding rates for bringing maturer candidates, perhaps having a change of career into the sector would be a good thing. And I also wonder whether there could be an opportunity to... It's a sector with high churn. People come in and often, sadly, when they have their own children, they can't afford the childcare, so they don't return to the sector, which is, it's not the best situation to be in. But perhaps there could be something around some incentive to bring people back into the sector, so some kind of golden hello, I suppose, to come in and join the sector alongside a supported training package, because things change really quickly in the sector. So could you have something that helped boost people's confidence and made sure their practice was up to date and their knowledge was up to date if they were returning to the sector after a period of absence? So there are a number of initiatives, and I know the workforce team at Scottish Government are looking at a number of initiatives on that. It would be really good to work really closely with the sector and get providers involved in that.
Well, thank you. Katie, do you want to come back in? Or, in fact, I would think Beverly's requested to come in. I'll allow Beverly to come in.
Thank you. Marie, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, thanks.
All right, thanks. I think one of the things for us would be to consolidate what we've already got. So there are, you know, there's lots of talk about where this funding's going to go for school-age childcare, or the 2-year-old places. There was the holiday provision, and then the money stopped. And so there's no security. So we've already spoke about the fact that we have clubs that are absolutely full with waiting lists, but we can't recruit staff to increase the numbers. But we also have clubs that are sitting at 60% full, so there's 40% spare capacity there that could be used for the type of, you know, children that we're hoping to get in the near future at very little cost, but would be much more secure to our sector. So I've got staff moving on, not because they want to, but because there's no security in our sector, because we might have to close some of these services that have got such low numbers in. So I think we really do need to consolidate what we've got instead of starting looking at other places to fulfil what's already there when there's already space there. Yes, I think that the way forward has got to be the school base is open 8 till 6 or 8 till even 8 if you want to include things like brownies and youth clubs and things like that, so that it's really flexible. But what you've got in there is different people doing different jobs. So we have staff who
work and support for learning assistants in schools and then come straight to us because there's not enough hours in a support for learning assistants job and it's only term time. And then there's not enough hours in a after-school club either, and it could only be term time. And so they put the two together, they're running two jobs to get almost a full-time wage. And if we could make that easier for people, so that improves their income and that improves their hours, you know, they get more hours and could do that, that would be good. And that, I think, would improve the diversity of those people that we would have in. You know, it'd be a full-time job at a reasonable rate. You want people who are play work qualified. You want people who have got child development in their background somewhere. You want people who have got sports backgrounds, dance backgrounds, any kind of the cultures and arts backgrounds, so that the children, the school, particularly the school-age children, would get all of these activities in one place rather than have to be ferried backwards and forwards to all different sorts of camps to get their football practice or get their band practice or whatever. But it all, you know, it would all be in a central point. So, but I think that's the only way we're going to get enough good quality staff that want to stay, I suppose like a pedagogy approach, that want to stay in the job and that we can be secure that we know parents have got this peace of mind and can go off to work.
Thanks, Beverly. That's interesting, some of the points you've raised there. Katie, do you want to come back in again? Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, just to Beverly on the point that she's making, which she covered in the First for Kids submission, just whether she's got any proposals as to how some of these ideas could be taken forward about, you know, perhaps people who are working in childcare also, you know, having roles as, say, classroom assistants. Has she got any, you know, practical suggestions as to how this could be taken forward?
I don't. I mean, recruitment and HR is not really my expertise, but I think one of the blocks is often support for learning is seen as, I suppose it used to be school-age childcare was as well. It's a little bit of pin money for, you know, when your children go to school, you can work in a support for learning assistance job. It's not highly qualified, not particularly highly valued, and it's only term time, it's a few hours. And so you can, home life fits in, and it's very female orientated, as much like childcare is. So we need, it's all of those things that's the same as childcare that we need to get past. So if we can value a pedagogy that does more than a support for learning or a classroom assistant or a play work, but, you know, is more about a mentor for that child, that they get all of these roles that we've got, we've divided up. I think we need to value the position, we need to value, and I think that, you know, it goes hand in hand with how do we value children and how do we value play work or play or their recreational time, and how important is that? I think there's also the question for me about should we be making parents work more hours rather than spend time with their children? So there needs to be a balance of, and that's where the flexibility comes in. You know, if people need to be able to choose whether they want someone else to look after the children or they want to work 40 hours a week, be absolutely shattered, not be able to do the homework, et cetera, et cetera. So that's where the flexibility comes in. But I do think it is definitely about valuing the post and valuing the child. And, it, and I think it's something we could do, like a social change, a cultural change, or how society views it. And we've done that for things like that are unhealthy, like smoking and all that sort of thing. So I think we need to do it about how important children are as well.
Okay, thanks, Beverly. I'm now going to move on to Marie, if you'd like to come in, Marie. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. It's great to see you here this morning. Thanks for your time. The written submission from First for Kids suggests the current system is penalising parents for choosing to work part-time and have the balance, you know, between family and work. And Chas highlights the flaws in the UK carers allowance system and how we can improve on that in Scotland. And I know that the committee is going to take some evidence on that in the near future. From a social security perspective, can the witnesses highlight anything else that is a barrier? For example, previous witnesses have suggested the increase in conditionality and universal credit is limiting choices. Also, as well, it suggested that 85% of childcare costs is covered under universal credit. Why not 100%? So how can families meet the remainder of those costs? So can you just highlight any barriers? Just start with yourself, Susan.
I think probably one of the biggest barriers is parents' understanding of what they're entitled to. I think there's a real lack of understanding about that, and it's not easy to get the information about what they're entitled to. So we try to signpost parents to any support that they can get financially, but people do find it complicated and do struggle to understand that, particularly our eligible twos as well. Families there, that being the way it's linked perhaps to some of the other benefits they're on and the low income, there are some of our families that we would have thought, because of other things in their family circumstances, that they would have been entitled to funding around that, and they haven't always been. So I suppose it's just quite a complex system, isn't it? And could it just be something that's more straightforward for everybody would be one of our requests around that, I think. So.
Anyone else want to come in on that? Rami?
For parents who are also carers and in receipt of carers allowance, there are challenges around the cliff edge of losing carers allowance entirely if the person earns more than £139 a week. So for some parents who are in receipt of carers allowance, there's a financial disincentive to look for childcare and look for work because they would lose significant money. And we certainly believe that that should be tapered off rather than there be a cliff edge at the end of 139 hours a week. And that would help and support many, many parents who are in receipt of carers allowance.
Anyone else? If not, thanks for those comments. Oh, Kirsty?
Would like to come in? Yeah.
Sorry, Kirsty.
Hope you can hear me this time.
I'll bring her on. We can, yep.
Yep. That's great.
Kirsty. You're breaking up again. I don't know if it's you tried switching your camera off.
Yeah, it's off.
Excuse me.
Yep. Can you hear me now?
No. Yep.
It was just saying about the universal credit and how it actually doesn't benefit people taking on extra work. I've got an example of a parent we had who was working 16 hours and universal credit, housing benefit, all the rest of it. But when she took on 32 hours, she's actually £100 a month worse off. And because she gets paid four a year, universal credit thinks she's been paid double in that month, and she loses all her housing benefit and her universal credit for that month every year, once a year. So she actually hasn't benefited financially by taking on more working hours, and her childcare costs have went up as well.
Thanks for that, Kirsty. What about other policy areas? For example, health and social care. Are there reforms needed there? And it would help parents with additional support needs. Rami.
And certainly, I mean, the solutions are complex, I think, but the challenges are significant. So there is a real lack of the ability for parents to, when they need support workers to be with their children, to find staff with the right skills. There's a real skills shortage. So there's a difficulty getting packages of care agreed with a local authority or a health and social care partnership. And there is a challenge then, even where a package is in place, being able to find staff with the right skills. I was talking to a parent just the other day who had a very significant package of support in place but was simply unable to recruit the staff that she would need to support her child And so she is giving up work to be able to be the sole carer for her child. So there is a real challenge around the workforce, the skill. There are also, though, examples of really good practice where children's community nurses are working with other staff in different systems to upskill them, including in childcare provision. So there are examples of good practice, but the magnitude of the problem is very significant in relation to children with additional support needs.
Thanks for that, Rami. Anyone else want to come in?
Who do you think wants to come in? Yeah.
Just on the question of children with additional needs, we have a number of times come across this, but it's happening right with us at the moment, where children with additional needs tend to have transport from school to home, and if they want to come to you at school care, then parents have to request that children go somewhere else. So, and the education authority refuse to send them to out of school care. They have to go to their home base. That makes it really difficult for parents. And the other thing is about equipment. So, you know, if we can have a child, if we have the facility for a child, do we have the changing facility for a child? And again, is it staff training? If there's any staff training that's needed, it's how we get, how forthcoming that training can be.
Thanks for those comments, Beverly. I'll hand you back.
Thank you. Now I'm going to move on to Paul now.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I'm particularly interested in looking at kind of eligibility and how do we continue to look at expanding provision, particularly for different age ranges. And maybe just start in terms of two-year-olds and the work that's been done there. Audit Scotland's recent report has obviously highlighted that progress is being made, but we still have further to go in terms of that piece of work. So I wonder if maybe just a sense from the panel, if they can, about are we getting it right in terms of how we are identifying those eligible two-year-olds? Do councils need to use more of their discretionary powers to get to more families? And maybe just, as I say, your initial sense of what's currently happening. Susan, do you want to start?
So I think we are making progress. There are eligible two-year-olds that are benefiting from attending services, most definitely. However, there's a wee bit of an air of stigma about accepting an eligible two-year-old place, because it's kind of, you get one of those places if there's a reason that you get it. So that there is a bit of a stigma around that for some families, and we need to get over that for a start. That's really something that just shouldn't be there. So we have to communicate around that in a different way to remove that feeling of not wanting to be one of the families that gets an eligible two-year-old place. We need to probably use a bit more discretion around that, and where a service has identified that a family is facing particular challenges, that the local authority are able to say, well, okay, they might not meet the definitions of what the funding would be, but we know because you've been able to show us that they're experiencing this and this challenge, and actually that child would really benefit from an eligible two-year-old place. So I think there is a definite need for discretion and real partnership working between the local authorities and the providers on that, so that we're providing that connected, holistic approach to supporting the family around that. And I think in the broader expansion to younger children, there is absolutely a need to be more in a partnership, in its truest sense of the word, relationship with providers, so that providers feel that they are being listened to, and that the challenges of the 3 to 4 year old expansion are not just repeated with the expansion for younger and also for older children, so that there is a real joined up approach to that, and any of those challenges are addressed before we just make them bigger by scaling that. So.
Kirsty would like to come in.
Sure.
Paul? Kirsty, can you hear us okay? Thanks. I think we've lost Kirsty.
Well, obviously, we weren't.
Oh.
Is that again?
Yes.
Yep, okay. We actually work in an area of high deprivation, so we do understand the benefits that children and the qualifying 2-year-olds get from... No, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, yep. Thanks.
Sorry. Am I back on?
Yes, we can hear you okay, Kirsty. Yep, do you want to carry on?
Sorry. We do understand the benefits available for children in this area to access childcare, but the local feeling has now turned into... They just feel that working parents are at... It's actually at the detriment of working parents. There's no place for them. We offer a creche and it's full of working parents because they can't access local authority childcare because they don't qualify. They're not classed as vulnerable, you know, because they're working, but they can't work if they don't have childcare.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, I mean, on that point, we obviously as a committee had submission from Early Years Scotland, I suppose, focusing on that point, that actually, you know, the thresholds, if you like, for access to that are quite limited. You know, 25%, I think, eligible and many families missing out. So I wonder if... My question, I suppose, is are those thresholds right or do we need to look at them and try and expand that? Susan, I don't know if you want to comment.
I think so many of the families that are working and are just above that threshold are probably pretty close to sitting in that sort of poverty area as well, and are struggling in lots of ways. And there is that balance of you just tip over that, so suddenly you've got that bill for childcare to pay, and perhaps now you're paying that bill, you're actually in a worse situation than some of the families that are qualifying for the funded place. So there's probably a need for more of the funded places just in general for families. But we have to get it right, because at the moment there's going to be an unwillingness from providers to enter into that. So we've got to get that model right so that we can provide those places and then look at that. Where does the threshold sit? How does it support families to work? And what's that sort of whole well-being approach to it? So maybe it's not to work, maybe it's to train, or maybe it's to support their mental health and well-being that they have that break too. So there is a big picture look at that, I think, needed to say why do families need that care, and it's not just about earnings, it's different reasons for that too. So
one of you just follow up that point. Obviously, a lot of the discussion we've had is about universal provision at 3 and 4. Do you see that there are significant challenges to try and have a universal system for 2-year-olds? And I mean, what work has been done that you can see that actually might be moving towards that position?
The biggest challenge, I suppose, like many things, comes down to cost and the funding of that, and getting the funding level right so that providers are able to do that. Obviously, the ratio of staff to children is different. So you've only got 5 children to each member of staff for your 2-year-olds, whereas you have 8 for your older children. So again, your staffing cost is higher again, which would actually call for a higher funding rate. We already, as providers, don't think that funding rate is meeting the cost of delivering that service for children. So I think that's the biggest thing. We have to get that funding right. And if that can be right, and if the workforce challenges can be resolved, then I think having that universal offer is good for all parents. But then beyond that, I also think there's a targeted need for additional support for families that are facing the most complex challenges in their lives. So.
One of them, just a couple more, convener, and witnesses are very helpfully leading my questions into the next area I'm planning to go to, which is always good. But I wonder if I can ask Rami on that point about families who require that additional support and who have different needs. Do you think councils are using flexibility at the moment in order to provide childcare, particularly in that 2-year-old bracket, or is there far more that could be done now within discretionary powers and in terms of wider looking at the eligibility to actually look at those circumstances?
I mean, I think that's a really important question, because we talk about at 3 and 4 universal availability. We don't have universal availability, and there are many hundreds of children who are not able to effectively find childcare settings that support them because of their very complex healthcare needs that are in place. And we have many parents who would like to work, who would like to be able to obtain childcare, but simply can't because the right settings with the right staff, and we've heard both about staffing and the physicality of the settings this morning, are not available. So I think that would be the first thing I would want to say. So, you know, I think there is always often goodwill from local authorities to try and be supportive, both from a childcare perspective and from a self-directed support perspective, but there is a lack of availability and settings that are suitable for all children. And I suppose at CHAS we work, you know, very much at the hard end of hard things, so with children who have very complex needs and have life-shortening conditions. But the points I would make would be, I am sure, relevant for children who simply have complex disabilities with no life-shortening conditions. So there is a real challenge. I mean, I was speaking to a parent in preparation for this today, actually, from the Lothians, a mum of a young girl called Ava, who sadly died a number of years ago, and she talked about the challenges that she had in trying to find somewhere suitable for her child. So she was saying that they were very lucky to have a child minder who was willing to take Ava and learn and upskill with community nurses to develop the skills she needed to look after her. She then, you know, Ava's needs changed, and that stopped being a feasible placement. So they tried a nursery placement, and that worked well for a short period of time. But actually, what was happening was that the parents were being called every single day to come and support with feedings or complexity. And so whilst there was a childcare place nominally, the reality was that those parents could not work because they were constantly being called daily away from their work. And in the end, one of the parents, the father, gave up full-time work to be able to care for that child and care for Ava. She talked about how school worked really well, and there was that worked really effectively, but the challenge was around out-of-school care, holiday clubs. These were simply not accessible to Ava, and that, I think, is a challenge faced by many, many parents across Scotland. So I think the point is less about eligibility criteria, but about the practicality of how this can be delivered for some of Scotland's most vulnerable children. And I suppose, sorry, Commissioner, what I might say is that when it comes to children with a life-shortening condition, those children are overwhelmingly likely to be from the very poorest postcodes in Scotland. There's a real association between poverty and life-shortening illnesses, so there is something that needs to be done.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner, are you happy for...
Yes, Susan, if you would
and
like to...
And then I'll ask my final...
Just a quick one, sorry. That's another area where we find that as providers we are supporting, really, through our own funds and our funders, the cost of this policy. We do have children attend some of our services who have quite complex additional support needs. And in some cases, we have gone back to local authorities and asked about additional funding. Perhaps they might need a one-to-one support, or we need a specialist piece of equipment. And often that funding isn't there. So we have to manage that within our own budgets or with support from some of our grant funders to try and provide those services. But the benefit for the children and families of being in part of that service with other children is huge, and it can be done. The facility can cope with it, the team can cope with it. We just need to be able to pay for the additional resources and staffing.
Thank you. Just finally, if I may, convener, we've spoken about 2-year-olds, keen though perhaps to understand a bit more about school-aged children. We don't currently have clear eligibility in that space. So I just wonder if there is a view about what kind of eligibility for school-aged children would be the most helpful in terms of trying to ensure we support people into work, keep people in work, you know, at this stage, as the government considers all of that. I if anyone wants to. That's a big question. I appreciate it.
Rami would like to come in. Thanks.
I mean, just to expand the point that I was making a moment ago about holiday clubs for children with additional support needs. I mean, where they are available, they are sometimes charged at a higher cost than holiday clubs for children without additional support needs, where specialist provision is put in place during school holidays. I was, hearing of one where a parent was offered a holiday club of 2 days during the course of the entire summer holidays and charged at twice the rate of the holiday club that would be available for mainstream children because of the complexity of the needs that was required for that child. So there is an inequity there, and I think that is a real challenge for being able to support that period of time and have parents being able to work during the school holidays. I think for children with disabilities, there is also a question about the older age range and the wraparound support that is available for older children who may not be able to be on their own but require support out with the school period as well.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. I believe Beverly wants to come in. Invite Beverly in.
Thank you. I think in the submission we quite clearly said what we thought the expansion priority should be. And I think for us it's those in work poverty, the parents who are, who are working and still in poverty. So those most at risk of having to stop work because they can't afford the childcare. Also lone parents who don't have family support around them. So, they're quite isolated, don't have parents in the next street or and people who can do the informal stuff for them. Those people who are newly engaged back to work, because it's quite a precarious situation for people to be, who have not worked for a long time, going back. There's a lot of anxiety around it. And so if we can take away that anxiety about what's going to happen to their children, then that we've got a better chance of them staying in work and maybe even getting better hours or less reason to not turn up at their work even. Respite for children or parents or families with children of children with a disability or a particular need. That is, as was just been talked about, it is expensive in comparison to, the business models are done on the ratios of what the care inspectorate think that you should have for children. So for our age, it's 1 to 10. Well, obviously, that changes if you've got children with additional needs in that, so it becomes more expensive. But certainly it should be a priority. The parents that we have who have children with disabilities that come to our services are so grateful because it's so difficult to get support for them. And the children have so much benefit from being able to be free and play with their peers. Anybody socially isolated that like needs support, particularly people who are new to the area or new to the country even, and they need time to settle or they need support to settle, coming to a community-based activity is good. And then also the very youngest children in school, so P1, 2s and 3s, it is absolutely fundamental that children enjoy those very, very early years at school, because it makes a difference to how they feel about school for the rest of their life. And they need to be able to build those good relationships, need to have that free time, that leisure time to enjoy that isn't necessarily about can they hold the pencil right or do they know this or do they know that. But it's associated with them being at school and their school friends. So those youngest children in school would also benefit most, I think. Thank you.
Thanks, Beverly. I just want to come in before I bring Gordon in to go on to the final theme. One of the things that that has coming through, particularly within my own constituency, was the in work poverty, but the challenges that both parents are working, they're paying quite a phenomenal amount on childcare, and they've applied for a mortgage recently and basically being refused a mortgage on the grounds that their childcare is so high, and then it's impacted on their credit ratings as well. Is that a thing that you've picked up on within your own areas at all? Maybe ask Beverly there when you were touched upon, you know, in work poverty.
It's certainly not something I have I've come across or any of our parents have said to us. One of the things we do all of the time when we send out our application packs is make sure we send out information about tax credits and the HMRC childcare vouchers so that parents know you can get help, whatever your income is, you can get help with your childcare. But that's certainly not something I've heard about using childcare as, and you know, having to mention what your childcare outgoings are as part of a mortgage application.
Okay, no, thanks. I don't know if Susan wanted to come in on that. You came across that point?
It's not something I've come across as directly as that, and certainly not in my current role since founding flexible childcare. But in my prior role to that, in more commercial nursery services, I've certainly been very aware of families whose childcare cost has been significantly more than their mortgage, and they've been really concerned about that. And in fact, families really that it was taking more than one whole salary of the two parents to cover the cost of their childcare. If you've got more than one child in full-time childcare, it's really, really expensive. So I can understand how that could very well be the case, because you would be declaring your outgoings on that application. So I can certainly see how that could reasonably be the case for families, yeah.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to pass over to Gordon now. Thanks.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, panel. We've talked an awful lot this morning about the challenges facing the sector, but I was wondering, looking to the future, and the government announced in October its approach to expanding childcare offer. And I know it had its consultation in the previous parliament about developing the policy, but I'm just wondering what involvement has the sector had in developing the policy that was announced in October about expanding childcare to school-aged children and to 1 and 2 year olds.
I think there have been consultation events, and obviously the sector membership groups are consulted and speak. I think there is always a clamour from the sector for more consultation and to have voices heard directly. Definitely. So there is a real willingness for people to share their expertise and want to be a part of that. It can be difficult. If surveys come out, you get multiple surveys from different things, so it can be a really hard way to gather that information from people. There's obviously, it's hard to be running around the country setting up consultation events and things, so there are challenges around that, and the routes into getting that everybody's voice heard can be difficult, but there is a willingness, and I think there would be a desire for more of that to happen. I think it's probably a fairly early stage at the moment, some of that work. My organisation, we've been working with the School Age Directorate through the CivTech programme, developing a piece of software to gather data around that type of service, both regulated and non-regulated school care provision. But that's still in development, about to go into user testing phase. So we are still at early stage of gathering that evidence and information. That data then will be an ongoing live feed of data that's there. So it wouldn't be a one-off piece of research that was done. There is a desire to be more consulted with and to get this right before it expands, because if we expand with the struggles that currently exist, there's a danger that the system implodes and that we just don't have a service for families.
I mean, as you quite rightly pointed out, the policy's at an early stage and there's clearly ongoing discussions, but do you feel those ongoing discussions are influencing the government policy?
I think in some ways, yes, to get the influence through to the government policy at national government level. It's harder at local government level. Once that filters down, there's often barriers there. So it's sort of that whole joined up thing, isn't it, that the people influence the policy. The policy comes down from government, but then it kind of gets a bit messed up when it hits local government areas. And I think that's really the sticking point for lots of providers around that.
Okay. Does anybody else want to come in on that point?
Beverly would like to come in.
Beverly.
Thank you. I agree, there have been consultations, and I have, as you all have heard today, I've got a lot to say for myself so often at these things. I do say quite a lot. But then things happen, and you wonder why, because the whole theme of that consultation and all the feedback that you've given, and something else turns about funding, so like this holiday money disappearing and Scottish football getting money to provide holiday camps. And you think, well, that's not what was said at the consultation. So you kind of, it's where, how does all that join up, and how does the information then filter? So I think, yes, we've been asked a lot, but there's not a lot that then is coming back to us about this is useful, and so we think we might go this way, or we think we might go that way. It's still very piecemeal. And I have to say, I'm not sure that how well we are listened to, fortunately. And locally, our local authorities know as little as I do, because I speak to them quite a lot. And this kind of, they've just got this 2 weeks' notice to put an application in for the capital funding that was released. And there wasn't much around, or much lead up to that. And so I'm not sure that will be money well spent, because nobody's had enough time to think it through properly.
Okay.
I think Kirsty,
please.
Kirsty, yep.
Yep. I just feel like this committee is taking evidence on parental employment, but there doesn't seem to be much talk of, if you have a baby, your maternity leave lasts 6 months to 9 months, if you're lucky. Then you're expected to go back to work. Well, if you're lucky enough to find a provider locally that you can use for childcare, it might cost you your week's wages. But in reality, if your child's 6 months or 9 months old, it's the capacity as well. There's nothing available. Local authorities don't provide childcare for working parents of babies. You have to wait till your child's three. You can't have maternity leave until 3 years old. So I think a lot of the issue as well is around capacity, actually finding somewhere where you can go.
Thanks, Kirsty. She's falling off. Yeah, so just moving on. Oh, sorry, Kirsty, you got more to say? You dropped out.
No, that's me. I just feel working parents are always at the bottom of the pile for access to childcare at all ages. And I don't understand how pre-5 childcare and after-school childcare isn't just part of the normal school day and the normal school week. We don't pay to send our children to primary 1 to 7, so why are we needing to pay to send our children to an after-school club? It's all part of their education, and it's all part of keeping your children in work. Keeping your parents at work, sorry. Why is it not just all one big shebang? I don't get how it has to be all these separate organisations and all these separate services providing, scrabbling for funding and all the rest of it. Just make it all part of the same state.
Okay, thank you. I mean, clearly a lot of schools, if we're looking at school-aged childcare, clearly a lot of schools already have breakfast clubs, after-school clubs and some form of holiday provision, but it's clearly not an ideal world. In a situation where in 4 years' time we want to see, an entirely different approach to childcare, what would that approach look like? And what's the level of task facing us? Susan, you want to start off?
I think I would like to see more of a sort of a hub model in some ways, from your youngest children and families right the way through. Perhaps school-age childcare within the schools, as we've been talking about, because we need to make better use of that school estate. But that sort of hub within the community that's providing the childcare, but also provides the wraparound family support, community facilities, so that it becomes a real asset for the local community, and it reduces the number of doors that families need to knock on for help, so that they can go to one place that they're comfortable in, that has the space for the childcare provision, but also for things like some of our services. We have a foster families use, so there might be the foster parents support group, a meeting room for that type of thing, for community groups to use for activities. And then if school-age childcare is also looking at incorporating the activity groups, like the dance and the brownies and all of those kind of things, that those premises could again be used for those kind of things. So the combination of that early-age childcare within a hub and then school facilities being used for that, and it being a really normal and accepted and easily accessible thing that your child can attend those services regardless of their additional support needs, so that the extra targeted funding is available for the children and families who need additional staff members, additional resources, or have other particular, they're living in extreme poverty and need support with access to winter clothes, to school uniform, to food, all of those kind of things. So just a much more holistic wraparound community-based type facility.
Do you think that's achievable if we get the funding model correct and we get the staffing levels right?
I do think it's achievable, yeah, absolutely. I think it's achievable. And I think there's loads of struggles. I mean, we really are facing an awful lot of challenges at the moment in the sector, but there is a real willingness from the sector. We're really adaptable and agile. People, through COVID, you saw just how adaptable and agile this sector is. So there's a real willingness to play a part on that. And providers that are supporting that policy financially at the moment by reducing what they bring for those funded hours is often less than what they would if they sold it privately. So there is a willingness. People could have chosen to opt out of that before now, and they haven't. With everybody, the skilled workforce that we have and the strong leaders in the sector, if we get the funding model right and we work in partnership with national and local government, all pulling in the same direction, not all these multifarious directions that are going off at the moment, then I absolutely believe that we can achieve that, and we have to achieve it.
Yeah, absolutely. Does anybody else want to come in? Rami?
I mean, very much concur with what Susan has said around, you know, the ambition of something being more seamless for parents, so that they're not moved from pillar to post between different systems, and that the systems are working together to support parents for those children who have additional needs. I think moving towards something that is genuinely accessible and provision that actually exists and can be accessed by parents and children every time is critically important, and done with a sense of equity. And I suppose the final bit I would say is that you're rightly focused on the childcare system, but not forgetting the social security system that wraps around that and supports many parents to either work or access childcare, and getting rid of some of the fairly easy traps that exist there would be a big step for a number of parents who rely on social security.
Okay, thank you. Beverly, I think you wanted to come in.
Thank you. Again, I concur about the hub. I think that's what I was spoke about earlier. If we had a system where, you know, the school was available to everybody, I don't know whether everybody needs to be employed by the same employer or how you do that in partnership, but certainly a hub where all of these things happen for a child. But I also think that we need to value it. So, it happens in Scandinavia, so we can definitely do it. But these people who work with the children in Scandinavia are pedagogues, so they are valued, and they are valued higher than we value our childcare staff or our playwork staff or our support for learning staff. And that's how we need to look at it. That we need to value the people who work with the children. Everything needs to be included. So we, at the moment, I rent a space in a school to deliver the service that we deliver.
and we get pushed from pillar to post. So if that school wants that space for something, we could have our let cancelled at the last minute. Parents have got no childcare because they get priority. So we need to be included. We need to be as much a priority as the school day is a priority. You know, it needs to be well respected. It needs to be well resourced. Do a lot of kind of upcycling of stuff. So, you know, it's a voluntary sector. You always make do with whatever you've got and try and make it last longer. But it does need to be well resourced, particularly for, you know, facilities where you've got children who need specific equipment. Mm. It would be ideal to have your own space in a school estate. So we're not, you know, I would love nothing better than a cabin in the playground of every school that I'm in. So that I can, you know, I can open the doors, kids get inside, get outside, and they've got free flow. But invariably, we're in the dining hall, and we've got a, you know, a half-mile trek before you get to the door to the playground, which can often be a concrete jungle. So it's not the best play area. And when we've got smaller schools, where things like out-of-school care is not really sustainable, do you need transport? And at that time of day, it is impossible to get any kind of transport unless you've got your own minibus, because all the, you know, all the drivers are being used to do school transport. So if we've got a cluster-based system and you've got three or four schools coming to one hub, then you do need to be able to transport those children. But also in the holidays, you need to be able to transport those children out on trips or out to local parks and all of that sort of thing as well. Theoretically, you should be able to use the system where all these children have now got free bus passes. But actually, the buses don't run often enough, so that doesn't actually work.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. That's me. Okay.
Thanks very much, Gordon. That's us come to the end of our evidence panel. So I'd like to thank the witnesses for the evidence that they provided and they've given today. And next week we will hear from two panels on employability programmes and education and training. So that concludes our public business today, and we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. So can I ask members who are joining us remotely, please use the Microsoft Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting. And thanks very much to our panel of witnesses who have came along today and who joined us remotely. Thank you very much. And that concludes the public meeting. Thank you.